My name is Dumela Musaka. I'm the curator for the art fair. And welcome to the first session of our talk series. The talk series basically, what I was thinking about as I was curating the fair was that I wanted each day, I've dedicated each day to a particular subject. And I've tried to find speakers who can reflect and engage in the subjects that relate to both art production, collecting, and so on. And so for today, a lot of the, as you see in the schedules, a lot of the talks sort of focus on the subject of collecting. And this morning we have a very distinguished guest, Dr. Albie Sachs, who is the former constitutional judge. But I think, something that really stands out and is very relevant for what we're all here to talk about is the fact that, he's both an activist as well as a committed lover of art. He's been very active and was very responsible for establishing the art collection at the Constitutional Court. And so, my idea was to try to pair some of very interesting people to pair them in terms of allowing them to have a discussion that can reveal some of the urgencies, some of the impulses behind collecting, behind the notion of value, how value is constructed, behind the meaning of collecting in its various ways. So I think for this morning, we have Dr. Albie Sachs speaking with Alexandra Dodd, who is also a very well-established writer and editor, who's contributed a lot of work towards newspapers and magazines, and has been involved with working with Dr. Albie Sachs in his most recent book called We the People, Insights of Artists, Insights, can't even read my handwriting now. Insights of an Activist Judge. So I think without any wasting a minute more time, we have a very packed schedule. And so after this talk, we have another one immediately. So for those who are gonna stay on, please feel free to just stretch a little bit, but then we're gonna pretty much go straight into the next talk. I think it's at 12:30, and we'll have an opportunity for questions and answers, and hopefully people will stay for the next talk. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to start with a short video clip. Okay, thank you very much, and thanks for being here this morning. I chose this particular excerpt from a documentary that was made by Lewin Simon and Lloyd Ross. And the reason that I chose this excerpt is partly because I found the reference to Judith Mason's work particularly poignant, considering that we lost her in December, and it was obviously an enormous loss for us as South Africans and art lovers. And secondly, because I think, I hope that we can bring some of the urgency of Albie's introduction to his discussion about Dumile Feni into the present moment and into this discussion today, the heat of 76 and the heat of the moment now, the moment that we're in right now and as we're speaking today. I greatly recommend watching the full docu, which is actually available on YouTube, because it actually shows it shows Albie's approach to collecting and building a collection that actually transcends a false and colonial binary between art and craft, between fabrication, making, art creation, conceptualism, which is present in the Constitutional Court, because it's about the windows, the doors, the carpets, the floors, the bricks, those are the things that came to matter in that collection as much as the art itself, and particularly also the site specificity and the hauntedness, the very, very heavy history of that place and how that came to play a pungent role in how we shape the collection. But first of all, I want to jump cut a bit, so in this discussion, back and forth in time. So I want to remind
Can I just
first,
add, please, we ended the film with the choir. Now those were our secretary, security people from the court, and we wanted the court to resound to the music of Africa, not to be a solemn, frightening place where people would come in and feel terrified by the majesty of the law, but to feel this is a place of humanity, if you like, the quintessence of humanity, particularly in a constitutional court. Sadly, the choir, after I left, the choir slowly disintegrated. But once I was at an international conference and I was saying it was actually in Mozambique, I think we're the only court in the world that has its own choir, and I use the word coro. And the Chief Justice there said, no, we also have a coro, a quorum. We use a quorum. I said, no, it's not a quorum. We actually have a court choir. And these are songs made up especially for the occasion when visitors come there. And that's all part and parcel of long before the term decolonization was there. We wanted a decolonized building in its feel, its architecture, its style, its fabric, and its relationships amongst the people. And seeing this now just brings back all those wonderful memories for me.
But first I want to rewind to the beginning. So your lifelong passion, its commitment to love, to visual and literary expression has been fierce and multifaceted. But often being passionate about art, and particularly collecting art, is viewed as a bourgeois or elite pursuit. But that's not always the case at all, and certainly I can testify for that in my own, my own haphazard collection and ways of collecting. But in your case, your parents were both involved in the Communist Party and trade unionism. Can you take us back to your childhood to give us an idea of the culture and spirit of your home? And what about your parents inspired in you this zeal, and it's a strong word, but an apt one, I think, for the arts and for art as a form of public and political expression?
Well, my dad, Solly Sachs, he was the General Secretary of the Garment Workers Union, in the Communist Party, expelled from the Communist Party for right-wing deviationism, which is a terrible thing, almost as bad as left-wing deviationism. He and my mom split up, so I grew up with my mom, I'd visit my dad. My dad was visually totally illiterate. He lived in his head, in dreams, sent me a birthday card, age 6, during World War II, may you grow up to be a soldier in the fight for liberation. I think that's pretty heavy for a 6-year-old, but that was his kind of vision. My mom, her dad was a tailor, she dressed nicely, she had quite a sense of style, but artists were part and parcel of our movement, and we all adored Picasso, because he was a communist and he was a great pioneer, and modernism was seen as revolutionary, and we loved the revolutionary notion of art, imagining a future freed from oppression. You mentioned bourgeois, I think we've got to hand it to the bourgeoisie. They did help promote art in their day, but for me the big moment...
Bourgeois and aristocratic, by the way.
Yes, earlier to be the aristocrats and maybe even many bishops, and I'm very secular, but you have to hand it to Mozart for the fantastic Requiem and great architecture coming in at that stage. But what was, I think, very special for me was belonging to the Modern Youth Society. We were very modern. For me, modern still means avant-garde. But this is now 60, 70 years ago. And somebody introduced us to the Mexican muralists. And we actually painted a wall in a warehouse in Cape Town where we met, based on Siqueiros and Diego Rivera. In those days, Frida Kahlo was the wife of Diego Rivera. Today, Diego Rivera is the husband of Frida Kahlo. And we did a mural of Cape Town, People's Cape Town, not tourist Cape Town. And it had dock workers and railway workers and street sellers and flower sellers. And we all worked on it. Unfortunately, the security police came in, we were chucked out, it was painted over. And we don't even have a photograph of it. But then years later, I'm in Mozambique, and revolutionary Mozambique, all over every wall, every building, had slogans, popular art. The city was populated by the proclamation of freedom, and then artists from Latin America, especially from Chile, from the Art Popular movement, got together with people like Malangatana, great Mozambican artist, with chosen sites cleaned. And one morning at 6:30, I was there, very nervously dipping a brush to follow a line that had been traced by Malangatana, feeling almost terrified of doing that. And it was very powerful form of expression. The art out there, not art for collection, but art in the street and art made by the people, with the people, and for the people. But we ran out of paint, and that was the end of that. And finally, my moment came. So my advice to you is never, never, never give up. Your moment might come. And the moment came when Arthur Chaskelson, now inducting the 11 members of the court, giving toss to each one of us, the library to Laurie Ackerman, and the gown to Tolly Madala, and rules to Ishmael Mohammed, and computers to Kate O'Regan, Yvonne Mahoro and I were left, and he said, can you do decor? And he gave us 10,000 rand, and we were able to buy one painting, which we made into a tapestry by Joseph and Glovu. But look what you can do. You saw a bit of that building with 10,000 rand. If you're a bit crazy, you believe in it, the artists are with you, the architects are with you. It was a moment in our history and in our own lives. And so we were able to introduce the artwork into the court with virtually no money. We're given with love, received with love, and creating, I think, a particularly wonderful collection.
Well, you've preempted my question, which had to do with the influence of your time in exile. But to flash forward then to where we are now, I'm wondering, you've spoken a little bit about you were in England for many years in exile. Then you were in Mozambique. You've not really spoken about England being an immensely a big impact in terms of your understanding of art, but you have about Mozambique. And so it must be particularly interesting to be present here at the art fair now, and also in South Africa, seeing the scene dramatically open up in terms of circuits of connectivity to the rest of the continent. And I'm wondering if any of the kind of connections that were forged in that time have been re-enlivened by this new kind of openness across the continent, particularly with Mozambique.
Well, certainly, it was such a different experience of art in England. There you would read about art, you would discuss it at dinner tables, you would go to galleries, but feel very passive. In Mozambique, it was very dynamic and very active. And Malangatana was so popular, I always say he was more popular than a football star. And it was a pain to walk down the street with him. Imagine a hot, baking hot Maputo sun, and you want to get to where you're going, and cars would stop with the air conditioning inside, the windows would come down, and some ambassador would talk to him, and he would talk. Then you'd move on, and there'd be street sweepers, and they would talk to him. And it just took ages and ages, the sweat pouring down. But he was so, so, so popular, and art was so meaningful. And art in Mozambique wasn't just doing interesting, pretty, challenging, critical things. What does it mean to be a Mozambican? Not to be a colony of Portugal, not to be a native, not to be a Shangaan, to be a Mozambican. And the poets and the painters did an enormous amount to reconceive what they called Mozambicanity, Mozambican Mozambican Nayadadi. It was something produced there. And there was a sculptor who would go into the forest to get his wood, and there would be what they call bandits there. Renamo were there. It was dangerous to get the wood for your work. And he would, in his work, he would say the story is in the tree. Somehow that translated from the story being in the marble in Italy of Michelangelo came through to Mozambique, the story is in the wood. And he'd say he'd go to sleep and he would dream what was in the tree, and the next day he would be working it out. And the piece that he did showed somebody bent over, you could see the ribs in the back, thin, cradling someone else, and the theme of it was the little bit of strength he's got is to comfort the dying person. This was so profound and so moving and so different from art in London. Would be shocking, it would be ultra conceptual, and here was art now emerging from the pains of the people and the creativity of the people. So that influenced me enormously, far more than all the art criticism. I loved reading. I fell out of love with Picasso while I was in England. It was a sad moment. Falling out of love is always sad. And he'd inspired me in all these years since being at UCT. And suddenly I looked and I thought, actually he's been too successful. He pioneered, he opened up, and everybody's copying it, and it lost that sense of zest and revolutionary, and the rather painfully intense work of Cézanne that didn't excite me so much in the day now suddenly seemed to have more. But these were interesting thoughts, but not thoughts that reached deeply inside me.
Well, I'm deviating purely in response to exactly what you're saying, that in many sense it flips the modernist paradigm what you're speaking about, because in some ways what you're speaking about is saying that the kind of action-based, communalistic, voice-based, collective-based approach to art that you experienced in independence here in Africa, in many senses preempts the dematerialization of the art object, the more practice-based approach to art that we're now seeing as contemporary in a transnational sense. So it's one of those many senses in which the sort of usual narrative of, you know, the West setting the trend and Africa picking it up, or the rest of the world picking it up, is actually a mistelling in some regards, that was always happening. But,
One of the most interesting foreign experiences for me was going to the Museum of Contemporary Art in New York. And one would go there to pay reverence to the great modernists, the people I loved so much, I grew up with. It was hallowed, it was quiet, it was empty. It was people in charge of it would be men, very suave and personable and interesting, and women with those New York hairstyles, with interesting kind of clothing, stylish, self-consciously stylish, and the place was empty. Now it's undergone a huge makeover, and they have lights flashing and lots of young people in there, and they've almost destroyed the solemnity of modern art. And there's a new vitality there. It's brash, it's loud. I'm not all that comfortable there because I'm just not young enough and noisy enough to manage it. But it's an interesting way in which even the modernism representation in New York has changed in the way Americans are very sensitive to what will get crowds in. And I don't think it's a sort of cheap populism. I think it's
maybe also part of the politics of America. I mean, being a necessary kind of politics there now, but maybe we can come back to that, because I want to return to the theme a little bit of, around collecting. And, the sort of the different imperatives that inform private collecting or a private collection, the intimate kind of imperatives that might inform building a private and personal collection versus those in building a public collection. Now, I know that addressing that question to an activist is pretty much, again, a false binary, because really public-private is pretty much one. But I just wonder if there is a difference for you in having in the kinds of things that inform making your own world around you visually and in public culture.
I think what was interesting for us in the court, how different it was from, you'll get Sanlam and, you know, big modern buildings now have artworks on the walls. It's stylish, it's cultivated, it's good, and they've done a lot to support art, and we encourage them to do that, and I enjoy going around. But we couldn't do that. We didn't have the funding. We didn't have a committee. So normally you have a building first, then you have a committee, and you get somebody in because you know how to make money, you don't know how to select art, so you get someone you trust, and there may be a few lay people on it, and you end up with, I don't know, not with what we ended up with. We didn't have the money, we had a building that wasn't built as an art gallery at all, but we had passion, and we had enthusiasm, and we had a few criteria. We had to take what we could get, and I say our collection collected itself. With a procurement committee, either one person dominates and that person's art becomes what you get, or you go for what nobody is too opposed to, the lowest common denominator or the feeble stuff. We just took what we could get. And the only criteria were, we couldn't have denunciatory art. There's a great need for art that denounces. And we had beautiful etchings by Victor, forget her first name, Diane, very powerful feminist drawings. We couldn't keep them there because we have so many cases dealing with patriarchy. And if we've got pictures up on the wall that say, you know, we've made up our minds, this is where we stand, then people who want to argue with it from a different standpoint would say, well, the court's made up its mind. So we didn't have denunciatory art. We went mainly for figurative art, the human being, fundamental rights of human beings, and then afterwards allowed for non-figurative art to come in. And then we had lots of art created by people who don't even know they're artists. They just do beautiful embroidery. They're from rural areas. And we brought them into the court and we said, that's the wall. And I remember saying to them, they were from Limpopo, please don't give us millies and assegais and crocodiles and huts. Give us your vision of Johannesburg, how you feel in Johannesburg. And we got wonderful semi-abstract works came out of interventions of that kind.
Okay, so I'm still going to try and push you a little bit further into the personal and intimate then. So, I could ask you what your favorite work of art in the personal collection is, but I want to take it a step further, because one of the things I find most compelling and mysterious about artworks, not all of them of course, but those powerful ones that have, that contain a kind of multi-dimensional contradiction in themselves, I guess, is the way that their meanings and import shift as we change and experience different chapters of being alive. So my question is, what work in your personal collection has taught you the most or had the greatest impact on your ideas, feelings or behavior?
I mean, I don't really have a personal collection. When I went into exile in England, I took a portfolio that was made at UCT of woodcuts and I think still screens. And my favorite of them was a picture by Peter Clark of a girl on a swing. It was so simple. It's like a reddish-brown color. It was so Cape Town, it was so Peter Clark. And it was a very affectionate and fond memory, a kind of exile memory. Then in London, I became very friendly with Dumi Lefeni, and you saw him in that little film. And he was living in a basement in a poor part of London, and a basement in a poor part of London is grim. And he just had a piece of string and his spare pants hanging over there and a toilet in the corner. But the most beautiful drawings that went right up to the ceiling. He would come round to our place, to our flat that had some central heating. You could sit on a chair, you'd have a nice meal, and just feel a kind of homely warmth. And one day when I was then married to Stephanie Kemp and bathing the kids and she's cooking, he's sitting alone waiting for us, and he did a little ink drawing of a penny whistler. And that is now part of the court collection. And that's become Travelled With Me as a very, very kind of favorite work. And I think my imagination runs to Dumile Feni. The work outside the court, called History, a sculpture, is very, very profound. And I was there just 2 days ago filming, and kids were sitting on the sculpture and playing. I just felt it's so great, you know. It's so wonderful that they can enjoy. They don't quite know why they're enjoying it, but they enjoy the fact nobody's telling them, don't touch. Art is not something, don't touch. Art is something you can embrace, you can sit upon. And that just pleased me enormously.
So it's fairly common knowledge that you've donated a huge percentage of your own personal collection to the Constitutional Court collection. But I think it's less well known that you also have donated a lot of work to the University of the Western Cape. And I was wondering if you could tell us a bit about your connection to the university and why that, what is that investment, what is that?
It's funny, you know, the verbs don't seem to fit donate.
I felt that before,
as you were saying it,
and
yes.
So
I'm in Mozambique and I'm with the artists, and there's civil war around us, but more artists made a living in Mozambique from the art than I would say in South Africa at that stage. It was just so prized. It was so much part and parcel of the expression of the revolution, the change of being a Mozambican. It was very profound. And that's something to do with the nature of the resistance in the former Portuguese colonies. All the leaders wrote poetry. Now, we would have been embarrassed if Nelson Mandela wrote personal poetry or Oliver Tambo. They could be quite soulful in their own way, but not poetry. You know, poetry is for kind of revolutionary sissies. And here's, we're passionate revolutionaries, in a romantic revolutionaries, if you like. And so that was the quality there. And I just ended up, we didn't have furniture. You couldn't buy furniture. You couldn't buy cups or saucers or teaspoons, but you could buy art. So I had lots of art. And then I'm blown up and the art is there. Mozambicans say, I can't come back. It's too dangerous. There'll be another shot at me. What to do with my collection? And I thought, I can't leave it there. It's there already. If I bring it to England, it will be in exile with me. It belongs in Africa. And then the idea came, it must go to UWC. And it was like cheeky. Let the art come because we're coming. Let the art come. What I didn't realize was the Mozambican customs were slower than the South African Revolution. So it just remained there for 2-3 years, and eventually it came forward. So I got back before the artwork came. And Siraj will probably remember that wonderful opening and being walking around and speaking about the artwork. It's still there. It's not properly hung. It's not. It connects up with the history of UWC as well.
Yes, that's what I kind of wanted to press a bit more. Why UWC? I mean,
you know, if it had gone to UCT, it would have been an art collection. And maybe very neatly and nicely displayed as an art collection. It would have somehow lost that fervor, open-ended quality. UWC was on fire, in a nice sense, passionate. It would integrate itself into the culture of this university that is about ideas, is about imagination, but is also about fighting injustice. And so it would take its place there very, very spontaneously and naturally. I managed to persuade Malangatana to come to UWC and paint a mural there, and it's outside the library. So that connection is quite strongly imprinted.
So now I'm bringing us up to the present. You're a board member of ZeitsMoCA, the new museum for contemporary African art. And I'm sure I'm not the only one who would wish to be a fly on the wall in those board meetings. So I've got two questions for you on that. What lessons learned or critiques leveled at the Constitutional Court collection are you importing to your role as a board member of ZeitsMoCA? My second question is, maybe this is a more where it gets into a bit more conversational, you know, discussion here, is, but I don't know if you want to go with that first or whether I should
let me deal with that. It's very, very much work in progress. We've been invited to, I think it's cocktails at the Silo Hotel tomorrow evening. And I'm really eager to see. This used to be the grain silo in the docks. And I love the idea that an old grain silo is now being transformed itself into an interesting public building. And my proposal was we should call it Maison Mili. But so far the rest of the board haven't jumped at that. But in a sense that captures the two dimensions. I think it should be elitist, have a pizzazz, a cosmopolitan quality, and it should be popular and rooted at the same time. And the art is to combine the two. And just one little example of an experience that we had. When we put up our new building in the site of the old Fort Prison, next to number 4 prison in Johannesburg, we had a big opening ceremony with judges from all over the world. The president spoke. It was formal, it was appropriate, that was fine. But in the evening, we had another opening ceremony for the workers, the laborers, the architects, the artists, and the others. And they gave a buzz and an energy to the building that you wouldn't get from the formal speeches. And I've been proposing we have something similar for the MoCA here, that it should appeal to people in Cape Town who maybe are frightened of art, but often have a great artistic sensibility, but they don't connect up looking at art and paintings and sculpture and debates and discussions with their sense of the beauty of a hairstyle or a necklace or a dress or of a space that you're living in. And I would like to see the ZeitsMoCA spanning those two and almost benefiting from the tension between the two. Because we don't have to blot out the international, the cosmopolitan, the trendy, if you like. Vanessa and I were in Rio a few months ago, and we went to the marvelous Oscar Niemeyer Art Museum outside Rio, and they were showing something which I really hope will be shown here, a work by Isaac Julian. Is it Isaac Julian or Julian Isaac? Isaac Julian. It was amazing on 7 screens. Now, I normally don't like video art. I was totally bowled over, and it's drowning 10,000 waves, and it's about China, and it was quite extraordinary. Now, we Cape Townians have a right to access to work of that kind, and we have a right to a building and a space and imagination that allows us to enjoy that, and everybody will enjoy it. So for me, that's going to be the crossroads, if you like, is going to be the key to its success.
Right. Yeah, I mean, to be honest, just sort of sitting very much outside of all that process, we hear a lot about a lot of donor dinners and cocktails, and it all sounds very, very high end. So as a lifelong human rights activist, I mean, I'm interested in the kind of dynamics of play inside of that board in terms of, pushing a very public and private interest. Yes, I agree they intersect. It's not a simplistic equation. but nonetheless, they also differ vastly. So I was sort of contemplating to myself, what would sort of arguing for public interest in that context actually constitute? I've got a few thoughts, but you know, what's it been so far for you?
Well, this one of the strong ingredients that the board members have made is to insist this be for the whole of Africa and the African diaspora museum. It's not South African art, it's art from the whole of the continent and people from Africa who are living in other parts of the world. And we have a team of people supporting us from Kenya, from Francophone Africa, from elsewhere. I think that's going to be an eye-opener for everybody in Cape Town. We, in some respects, we are very parochial. We find it with music. There's much greater knowledge and understanding of North American music in Cape Town than there is of West African music. If you want to hear good West African music, you go to New York, and whereas we could get the people coming here, something similar could apply in relation to contemporary art. That's already been accepted as part of our vision. And there'll be other ways in which we will expand imaginations. But I'm also very keen, for example, the extraordinary work that's done, the handspring puppets with the people from what's the small town?
Barrydale.
With the marches through the street with these enormous puppets. This is so South African, it's so local, it's so participatory, and we have high-end art and popular art and community art. They're not in opposition. If the energies and the skills interplay with each other, you get something very, very, very special.
Right.
And I'm hoping that we will be able to. The cocktails are there because there's always a search for money and funding.
Okay, I want to leave a bit of time for questions, so I'm going to cut through to my final question, and that is, in your renowned and provocative paper, Preparing Ourselves for Freedom, which you delivered in 1990, you called on your fellow ANC comrades to desist from saying culture is a weapon of struggle. With a real weapon, there is no room for ambiguity. A gun is a gun is a gun. You wrote. But the power of art lies precisely in its capacity to expose contradictions and reveal hidden tensions. So under the current conditions of state capture, unaccountable governance, and the extent of corruption that we're experiencing, you know, widening the wealth gap to desperate proportions, it's clear that the role of art as activism is emerging again with renewed urgency. You know, we've got Inkandla, Gupta Gate, the Marikana massacre, increased police violence and brutality, the trillion rand secret nuclear deal, etc. So for me, this imperative around you know, pushing a particular agenda within spaces like Zeitsmoker or even here at the art fair, you know, there's political and there's political. So I'm just interested to know how you are. I know that you resigned as a constitutional court judge in 2009, but you've been working daily all the time, and I'm just sort of interested in how you're pushing that agenda in the present tense, considering the kinds of politics we're experiencing this kind, and also globally, Trump. You know, rampant spread of capitalism, I mean, advanced state capital, you know, league capitalism, you know, the radical repression of human freedoms from the imperial warlord, you know, what's the role of art here now, and how can we advance that, what are you doing about that?
I mean, from the way you're presenting it to me, you want your machine gun. Machine me one, right?
No, I don't. I don't. I'm a pacifist. I think that's actually a key point. I don't want machine one. I don't want the new deal. Yes. For example, there's a high militarization, and I'm saying that art's got an extra urgency in relation to that, as far as I can see.
I think life has got extra urgency and art is part of life, but I don't see it as a particular burden on or responsibility of artists as such. I think artists work well when they experience and feel and have a connection with the world that seeps into their unconscious, their soul. They think about it, they reflect, and then it comes out mediated by rich internal technique, partly what your fingers and hands can do, what your eye can do, what your heart imagines. And I don't think it should be, sometimes you get a Guernica that's promoted, sponsored by a terrible atrocity, and that's the reaction to it. But Picasso had been building up and building up a form, a technique, a responsiveness, a style, that came out at that moment. Today, what encourages me in South Africa, I could counterpose what you're saying, that in Trump, millions of people marched, and there's a huge movement, and Trump is creating counter-Trump and energizing people who've been quiescent and quiet and speaking out and reclaiming their dignity and their space and what it means to be an American. And there's a lot like that happening in South Africa now. And for me, what's powerful is the extent to which we are an open society. People speak their minds, they can criticize, and it can be done in all sorts of ways. And we have our artists, maybe some people would say it's cheap, it's easy to show the president's penis or to say fuck the whites, that's shortcut kind of art, but we have an open society, people choose their modalities of presentation. I don't think that's going to be profound. It's quick, it's shocking, it's immediate, it's debated, it's argued over. But three things please me deeply in South Africa. The one is the way our constitution is holding, our elections are meaningful, our courts are standing firm, our civil society is strong. We're an open society. That's number one. Number two, our biggest growth industry is stand-up comedians, and they come from all the communities. And that says something about what it means to be a South African. We laugh, and we laugh at ourselves and our own communities. It's actually quite wonderful. And the third is, I think that we have outstanding artists and artistic creation. When I go to a gallery in a foreign country, I might be interested, might be intrigued. I'm not moved. Here I'm moved. I'm moved. I feel engaged. I feel challenged. And I feel in that sense, it's exciting to see new galleries are opening up. I wish there was far more opportunity in the townships, but there are people in the townships who are working to create platforms for expression. And I think that's a rich area in South Africa. One of the tasks of the new museum here would be how to connect up without becoming simply a siphon for the exquisite, beautiful, wonderful art that now might, like I saw something, Isaac Julien living in London now, shown in Brazil, comes to Cape Town, maybe there'll be something from Cape Town that will go to Brazil and then to London. And we want that. We want high-end art. We want art that's right at the edge. Art at the edge now is not just technical and conceptual. It's emotional, it's spiritual, it's deep. And it's using all the possibilities of technology, not simply to display technological skill, but to reveal the human self quite profoundly. We want that. But we also want that feed-in connection with communities, and that's going to be our challenge to get both.
Thank you, Albie. Let's open it up. We've got, unfortunately, quite a short time for questions, but let's please go ahead. Yeah.
I wish they'd shut up out there.
fringe drama. I wonder if you could talk a little bit more about this idea of defamatory art. I think it's much the term you use, just is that the correct term, and its place in public art collections, and perhaps look at it in relation to Alex's last question, because it's something that's troubling me. One of the things I was thinking particularly of is, you mentioned Diane Victor. I was thinking also of the oppression of her work that happened in the law faculty at the University of Pretoria, where she set up what I think was a very sophisticated parody of Goya's Disasters of War, repositioning them as Disasters of Peace, in which she offered a highly critical but very upsetting engagement with atrocities that happened in post-apartheid South Africa. Putting them in the law court, I think, in a way that in the law faculty, and into the center of peace and justice, where they were very apt. But people didn't want them on the wall there because they were upsetting. And her role, I think, and her position in relation to art has always been to try and provoke and upset people as a critical engagement. And I wonder if there isn't a place for that kind of approach within public art settings. Art that necessarily doesn't make people feel good, but is sophisticated, but also upsetting. And I just wondered if you could perhaps pursue that a little bit.
Okay, I couldn't hear that all that well. One result of the bomb blast that affected me is if there's a lot of background sound, my ear doesn't pick up. But I think I got the gist of it, and it's really the role of denunciatory art, but where it becomes very specific, very intentionally directed at particular targets that can be maybe easily identified. And I think I'm going to lose my audience now. I get a sense most of you have been enjoying what I'm saying, and I'm going to risk it all. It was in connection with the de-invitation by the University of Cape Town of the Academic Freedoms invitation to the publisher of the Danish cartoons to come and speak in favor of academic freedom, to test the limits of academic freedom. And Penn International, Penn South Africa, invited me, almost pleaded with me to participate. I said, "Oh, no, I'm not going there. You just get into troubled waters and everybody gets pissed off with you on all sides." But then I woke up one morning, I thought I had the answer. And the answer in the first place was, you don't withdraw permission for someone to speak because you fear there'll be violence. So that troubled me. But I felt there's a more profound reason why he should never have been invited in the first place, and it should have been seen as a mistake. And that's the nature of the university community. The university community is there to criticize, to be open, to get the debate where it can go. But it's also a community of human beings. And you feel it so strongly in Cape Town. We have a large Muslim population in Cape Town, a rich part of our history, came as slaves, suffered oppression, resisted oppression, and they're part and parcel of the very picture of our city. This is the University of Cape Town. And we have many Muslim students at UCT. And if the university can't be a place where everybody feels welcome to be who they are with their beliefs and their sensibilities, then I think it's losing something much more than simply the right to criticize and to be critical. And so I came down quite strongly then in saying it was wrong to invite him in the first place, and certainly it was correct of the university authorities to de-invite him. And I still hold to that position. I don't know the particular exhibition you're speaking about in Pretoria. Was it withdrawn? I'm actually going to Pretoria next week.
No, the works were put up in a public space, and then they were forcibly removed because literacy.
Right, okay. So maybe when I go there...
I consulted, others didn't like them, and they were removed. And they're quite provocative works.
Right.
It struck me as that they were appropriate provocative
works. What I have written about before, a piece called Free Spirits and Ravaged Souls. We had a case in our court, the Loffert Off case, parody. And I wrote very powerfully about the importance of humor, of wit, of criticism in our society. Then there was the famous Zapiro cartoon showing President Zuma about to rape Lady Justice being urged on. And I felt very uncomfortable with that cartoon. And why? Because it was picking up on, not intentionally, Zapiro is a freedom fighter. He was imprisoned in the struggle. His mother was a Holocaust survivor. But I think he didn't show enough sensitivity to picking up on what is a kind of a stereotypical vision of the African male. It feeds into that. It's not his intention, but it's there. And people like Wally Cerotti and others were distressed. They spoke about their ravaged souls. And I feel artists should be sensitive to that, not because they're being commanded or because the law will get them, but in their own souls. They should say, okay, you can provoke, but it's not all that daring, if you like, to kick people who are wounded, who are bleeding. The word pain has been used a lot in us in recent discourse, to have a great understanding of how other people in your community, in your society, would interpret and feel and respond, and to do so in a respectful way. Maybe you still end up with your combative and denunciatory style, I don't know. But certainly when I go to Pretoria, I'm going to try and find out more. Thank you.
I mean, obviously this is such an intense hot topic, this question of radical and total freedom of expression or not. And I think it's a good, we unfortunately have to cut it here, but hopefully we can take this discussion outside and continue it, you know, let's keep the debate going. So thank you so much, Albie. Yeah, that was a really great conversation. Thank you very much.